Okay. So I'll continue now I'll talk a little bit more on some of the applications that we're doing with single wall part nanotubes in particular. Be a little bit of graphene in here, but we've really only started recently working with graphene, so most of our publications and great results have come from nanotubes, especially for photovoltaics. So just as a quick reminder from the last talk, the reason we're interested in nanotubes, we like them as solution processable absorbers and wires. So if we look back to this nice figure here of the different nanotubes produced by different synthetic methods, they overlap well with the solar spectrum, they have long aspect ratios, very high carrier mobilities, and you can make them into multifunctional thin films. So essentially, this is a three-dimensional thin film. This is, I think, from Yao and Lagerman's paper. I'll touch on it again a little bit later. So this is a nice two-dimensional thin film of nanotubes that have lots of different junctions and tubes in there. And these films have tunable optical properties. They can transport electrons through holes. And they have high surface areas and large void densities. So you can think about interpolating different species in there to make these nice hybrid systems. So a couple things that I'll talk about today in terms of using single-wall carbon nanotubes and photovoltaic active layers are these heterojunctions, bulk heterojunctions. In one case, we'll be interfacing nanotubes with P3HT, so polyprehensyltryptophan. In this case, we expect when we photoexcite, essentially when you look at the homologous potentials of these two species, they form a type 2 heterojunction in which when you photoexcite the P3HT to form an exciton, you get electron transfer from the P3HT LUMO over the nanotube LUMO. You can also get hole transfer if you choose the right diameter of nanotubes. In this other case, so this is from Mike Arnold's group. I touched a little bit on his work. He was the pioneer of density gradient ultracentrifugation for nanotubes. He has been pioneering another type of device here where you interface nanotubes with fullerene layers, to make either bilayers or intercalated bilayers, like bulk heterojunction. And in this case, the energy levels line up such that when you photoexcite the nanotube, you actually get electron transfer from the nanotube over to this fullerene species. So we've had Dominic Bendel in our group for the summer from his group, just kind of as an intern for the summer, doing a fun little project that I'll touch on. In the second part of the talk, I'll talk about carbon-based transparent conducting electrodes for organic photovoltaics. So in this case, you're actually making these large area of single-wall nanotube films or graphene films, single-layer, two-layer, three-layer, and actually using them to transmit light through to your active layer and then collect the charges from your active layer. So if you kind of think about both of these two applications, you could theoretically envision an all-carbon solar cell where you're using carbon in your active layer and carbon as your electrode as well, at least in our pie-in-the-sky mentality. So in these studies, the reason I touched so much on the separations in the last portion is in these studies, what we're really trying to do is understand the role of electronic structure in these different devices. So as I said, these things are really polydisperse. What we'd like to do to understand how these things function in real devices is to separate them by electronic structure or diameter to get nice narrow distributions of species where we've got maybe one or two species in solution at one given time and one or two species in a device. This is probably, I probably don't have to go over this since it's probably been touched on in many of the other talks, but this is just the basic anatomy of an organic photovoltaic. You form a bulk heterojunction between your donor and acceptor. The donor, in this case, the prototypical donor, is a semiconducting polymer like P3HT. The prototypical acceptor is this PCBM fullerene species. So when you photoexcite this blend, you get electron transfer from P3HT to PCBM, and the charge transport for the electron is this percolating fullerene network. So we've been interested in looking at nanotubes as other alternative acceptors in these organic photovoltaic devices. And the nanotubes have a few different potential benefits. For one, you've got a very long aspect ratio nanotube. And as we said, this gives you very high mobilities, very good electron and hole transport. So in comparison to a percolating network of fullerenes, you might get better electron transport in these types of devices through the nanotube phase. You can also tune the nanotube absorbance, so you can envision tuning the absorbance of the acceptor in this case to actually absorb light and contribute to photocurrent by hole transfer back from the nanotube to the P3HT. The problem with these devices is the efficiencies are have been very poor, less than about 0.1%. At this point in time, when we started this about a few years ago, back in 2009, we realized that we really needed to do some basic studies to figure out why the efficiencies were so poor. So here's some fundamental questions to ask for these type of donor acceptor blends. First off, we'd like to know just a baseline demonstration that you get exciton dissociation at this interface. So on paper, we think that we have this type 2 heterojunction for nanotubes and P3HT, but can we actually see this exciton dissociation process? So do we get electrons transferred from the polymer to the nanotube, and do we get holes transferred from the photoexcited nanotube to the polymer? How quickly does this charge-separated state decay after photoexcitation? So you want these separated charges in these two phases to last for a long time, so you can create a nice solar cell. And then what factors limit the yield and or the lifetime of this charge-separated state? We'll talk a little bit here about electronic structure and also diameter, which I accidentally took off here, but metallic tubes versus semiconducting tubes, and picking different diameters to vary the homolimo potentials of these different types of tubes. So this first case study we'll talk about is the donor's polyhexyl 3-thiophene, and the acceptor are laser vaporization produced single wall carbon nanotubes. So the first thing that we can see, which is just a good prelude, is that semiconducting polymers do a great job at dispersing single wall carbon nanotubes. So as I said before, really the precursor to making any of these types of devices is to disperse the nanotubes into solution. Then you've got a nice dispersion that you can spray, you can spin coat, you can do whatever you'd like to with. Typically those are done in aqueous surfactant solutions, but if you use a semiconducting polymer like P3HT, MEHPPV, PBTTT, you can do these types of dispersions in organic solvents as well. So this is nice because essentially what this tells you is you have the semiconducting polymer where you'd like to dissociate the exciton at that interface in intimate contact with the nanotube. That's the only way you can debundle these nanotubes and get this nice dispersion of individualized semiconducting nanotubes. When you do these dispersions, you make these dispersions, this is an absorbent spectrum of laser vaporization tubes. The green sample is, the green spectrum is the laser vaporization tubes dispersed with polyhexyl 3-thiophene. This is the band for P3HT. The isolated case is shown here in red. The blue trace right here is when you take P3HT and add a pore solvent. When you do that, when you add that pore solvent, the P3HT tends to aggregate, and you form these aggregates where you have a little bit longer conjugation length, and you get this, you get these red shifted bands for the order P3HT. When we disperse the nanotubes with P3HT, you get the same type of side peak for this ordered P3HT. So the P3HT actually orders on the surface of these nanotubes. The nanotubes actually kind of act as a little seed to order these little crystallites of P3HT. The next thing we can look at is just photoluminescence quenching. So a really simple experiment where we look at photoluminescence of P3HT film on its own, and then our film with the same optical density of P3HT, but now we've added a few percent of single wall nanotubes. And we get quenching of the photoluminescence of the P3HT. Anywhere from about 85% to 95%, which is good, because this tells us that excitons are being dissociated. But this measurement cannot tell you if you're getting exciton dissociation by charge transfer, it does not tell us that excitons are dissociated. It tells you either that excitons are dissociated by charge transfer, or you're getting energy transfer of the exciton over to the nanotube. So transferring both the electron and hole over to the nanotube as well. So the first one of these experiments that we did first is to look for this energy transfer. And when you do this photoluminescence excitation spectroscopy, you can look in two different regions. So this is the region of the nanotubes. So we're photoexciting at the second exciton level for the nanotubes here, watching emission from the nanotubes. But you can also zoom in here on the polymer region itself. So this is emission from the tail end of the polymer emission. And you're photoexciting right here around the band gap of the polymer itself, around 500 nanometers. But what you also see is these peaks out here between 1500 and 1700 nanometers. And these are peaks that arise from emission from the carbon nanotubes themselves. So essentially what this is telling you, if you take these slices, you see these nice little peaks that match up really well with these positions for the semiconductor tube emission. What this is telling you is that you are photo-exciting the polymer and then transferring an exciton over to the carbon nanotube, which then emits in the carbon nanotube. So this is just energy transfer. You're not actually dissociating the exciton by charge transfer. The nice thing here is if you take a slice that is vertical here and map out this energy transfer process, you get this nice bump, you get this nice excitation spectrum that overlaps really nice with this little bump on the side of the P3HT spectrum. And that bump, again, if you remember back to the couple slides ago, is a bump that arises from P3HT ordering on the surface of the nanotubes. So what this is really telling you is that the P3HT that's bound directly to the surface is very efficient at undergoing energy transfer to the nanotube. So that's bad if you're thinking about making a solar cell, because if you're doing energy transfer, you're not dissociating excitons, you're not getting an electron in one phase and the hole in the other phase. So this may limit the ultimate efficiency of devices. But what we wanted to know at that point in time is, can we look at measurements to probe whether charge transfer also occurs? So in this case, we need measurements that are sensitive to free charge carriers or dissociated excitons. So this is a technique that has probably been covered in quite a few talks. This is a measurement that Gary Rumbles and Nikos Kopodakis brought to NREL, and Andy Ferguson has a lot of measurements as well. So this is time-resolved microwave connectivity. Essentially, in this measurement, you have a pulse laser system with about a 5 nanosecond pulse. You can send that through an optical parametric oscillator that gives you a tunable light source. You have a microwave source that produces microwaves that interact with the sample, and you detect those with your detector. If you focus in here on the sample compartment, the sample compartment is essentially a cavity where you get multiple passes of your microwave back and forth through your sample, which can amplify your signal. In the case of nanotubes, we get really strong signals, so you don't actually have to use the cavity. But the basics of how this measurement works is we have our sample here. So this is a polymer encapsulated nanotube sample. So this is P3HT encapsulated nanotubes. You have your microwave beam that passes through the sample. If you haven't photo-excited any charge carriers, the microwave beam simply passes through and doesn't really interact with your sample. So you get some level of power through your sample with the label P. You then photo-excite this blend. If you get exciton dissociation, you create free charge carriers. These free charge carriers interact with the microwave signal. The microwave signal moves these carriers around, and you actually get an attenuation of this, the power of this microwave. So you've got this P minus delta P. If you do, this is just kind of like a normal transient absorption type measurement where your delta P over P signal, or your delta P over P signal is proportional to the density of these free charge carriers times their mobility, times the sum of their mobilities. So what we have in this case is, this is time, and we don't have any photoexcitation here, and then all of a sudden we photoexcite this green pulse. We get exciton dissociation and create free charge carriers, so this gives us a rapid rise of this microwave signal, this delta P over P. You reach some delta G max, which tells you something about the yield of free charge carriers, and then these things start to recombine, and this delta G signal essentially decays. So you can learn something about the density of free charge carriers, their mobility, as well as their recombination kinetics. So we made a few different samples for this measurement that are solid state samples, where we've encapsulated the nanotubes in a polymer matrix. So remember, our main polymer that we're looking at, the photoactive polymer that we're looking at, is P3HT. We also use an inert polymer, CMC, which is carboxymethyl cellulose. Essentially, that's just a polymer that forms a nice matrix around the nanotubes, but it's not photoactive and its band gap's very large, so you're not actually going to transfer any charges to that polymer. So these are the samples right here. So this is P3HT alone in red, P3HT with nanotubes in blue. So you can see if you zoom in on these peaks here, these are the nanotube peaks. And these are nanotubes in CMC, where there's no photoactive polymer. So we're looking for these two cases, one where we photoexcite the polymer and see if we can see electron transfer. The other, if we photoexcite the nanotubes do we see this whole transfer reaction? So here's the first experiment. This is the inert matrix. So this is the CMC matrix where we don't expect to see any charge transfer. In this case, we're photoexciting at two wavelengths, 532 in the green and then 1064 in the infrared. Here are those two excitation wavelengths. This excitation wavelength in the green is right on top of the peak HT absorbance, and this excitation in the infrared is right on top of the second excitonic transitions for the semiconducting nanotubes. So in both cases, when we photoexcite the nanotubes in this inert matrix, we get some density of free charge carriers. So there's some carriers that are probably trapped, leading to mobile carriers in that matrix, but they recombine very rapidly. So you get pretty much almost an instrument response limited decay, maybe a little bit of a long decay here. But rapid decay of photoexcited free carriers just tells us that we don't have any charge transfer to that CMC polymer. So we have a much different case for P3HT, and I'll step through each one of these kinetic traces. So the first one we're looking at here is photoexcitation at 1064. So again, that is photoexciting the nanotubes themselves. When we photoexcite the nanotubes themselves, again, we see this very fast, pretty much instrument response limited decay, which indicates that we don't have any charge transfer. If we do have charge transfer, essentially what we'd expect to see is the carrier separated into two different phases, so that would slow down their recombination and lengthen this decay time. So we don't think that we see any kind of longer-lived signal from this photoexcite the nanotubes themselves in P3HT. So what this tells us is when we photoexcite the nanotubes in P3HT, the excitons behave just like they do in an inert polymer matrix like CMC, so there's no hole transfer. We step next to the green excitation. Here what we're doing is we're photoexciting P3HT. When we photoexcite P3HT, we get this huge jump in the signal. So this is pristine P3HT on its own with no nanotubes in there, multiplied by a factor of 100 to get it on the same scale. When we put a small density of nanotubes in there, 1 to 5% of nanotubes in P3HT, when we photoexcite P3HT in that case, we get this huge jump, 100-fold jump in the signal, which tells us we've excited a lot more free charge carriers. Those free charge carriers arise from photoexciting the P3HT, getting electron injection into the nanotube, and these charge carriers are much longer lived. The signal decays with a much slower time constant than they do in pristine P3HT or nanotubes alone. And that slow time constant is because we've now separated these charges in different phases, and they have to search out for each other a lot harder to actually recombine. If you look at this kind of a long time constant here, comparing a long time trace here, comparing CMC, nanotubes in CMC to nanotubes in P3HT, and you get much, much longer lived carriers in P3HT, and they live out to microsecond time scale. So these are the types of long lived charge carriers that you would actually collect on the device. So next we'd like to know how the electronic structure affects this charge separation efficiency. We know that when we photoexcite P3HT, in a sample of mixed nanotubes. So these previous samples that we looked at were mixed. They had 1/3 metallic tubes and 2/3 semiconducting tubes. We do see charge transfer, but we also need to think about what the metallic tubes are doing in this. As I said before, you really want a semiconducting tube because the semiconducting tube has a true band gap, and once the electrons reach this band edge, they can't really go anywhere. The metallic tubes, on the other hand, don't. They have a finite density of states all the way down here to this P3HT HOMO, and so you should expect them, theoretically, to act as charge recombination centers. So we took our mixed nanotube dispersion, separated it out by density gradient ultracentrifugation to get different levels of semiconducting content. So this is 12% semiconducting tubes, which means the rest of your sample is 88% metallic tubes, all the way down to 90% semiconducting tubes, 10% metallic tubes. We then took these and redispersed them into P3HT to give us these P3HT blends with varying levels of semiconducting and metallic tubes to try to probe exactly what the metallic tubes are doing in this type of blend. So when you do that, so this is a transient again, these are comparison of transients again. What you see, this is the black case right here is pristine P3HT, so no nanotubes in P3HT at all. The red traces are metallic tubes at simply different fluences, but it's not really important. These are metallic enriched blends where we have about 88% metallic tubes. So you can see that the recombination time is just as fast or maybe even a little faster than pristine P3HT. Whereas the semiconducting enriched blends that are 90% semiconducting tubes, you get this nice long-lived signal which is due to that exciton association across that interface. If you take this, you take the delta G measured, so this is the yield times the mobility measured at 400 nanoseconds, divide that out by the peak, that essentially gives you a relative measure of the long-lived carriers that you see at this type of blend. As you systematically increase the percentage of semiconducting tubes, you systematically increase the number of the separated charge carriers in that blend, the free charge carriers in that blend. So that, what that really tells you is you need to look at these semiconducting enriched blends to actually make functioning OPV layers, because the metallic tubes simply act as recombination centers. Drawing upon those results, there have been some nice recent strategies at actually making semi-enriched polymer blends in kind of a quick one-step process. We actually took these, made aqueous dispersion, separated them out by density gradient, ultracentrifugation, and redispersed them in P3HT. That's a lot of steps to actually make a device. It's not really practical. The Janine Bao group found that if you used certain polyalkyl thiophenes and chose the sonication and centrifugation conditions correctly, you could end up essentially making these semi-enriched blends in one step. So this is just a Raman spectrum looking at difference of these, the Raman spectrum in this region. This is a radial breathing mode. The Raman spectrum in this region is dominated by metals. The Raman spectrum in this region is dominated by semiconducting tubes. This is the as-produced sample and the semi-enriched P3HT sample where you have all semiconducting tubes. There's also a nice recent report out of Rob Nicholas's group where essentially they take PFO dispersed tubes. So if you think back to my previous talk, these polyfluorine polymers are great at dispersing near single chirality semiconducting tubes. So you'd ideally like to use those in your devices. So if you take those PFO wrapped semiconducting tubes and add in some P3HT, the P3HT will actually displace the PFO from the surface. And then you can do one more centrifugation step to get rid of the excess PFO, and you're left with near single chirality P3HT dispersed tubes that you can then make your blends with. So nanotube P3HT devices using semi-enriched blends and drawing upon some of these results in the past couple of years have now reached up to about a 1% power conversion efficiency, which isn't incredibly high, but it's getting much better. It's an order of magnitude better than it was just a few years ago. So these are pretty good steps forward. So this is another type of device where you can actually dissociate nanotube excitons very efficiently if you use fullerene acceptors. So again, this is work out of Mike Arnold's group at University of Wisconsin. Dominic Mendel is his grad student who has been working on these devices where essentially they make a bilayer of nanotubes that are dispersed with PFO. So again, semiconducting enriched PFO dispersed tubes, a small number of species, a small number of semiconducting species, in a bilayer with C60. So essentially they evaporate C60 on top of these semiconducting enriched nanotube thin films. when you photoexcite these blends, this is just a normal IV spectrum where you get a normal IV curve where you get a nice photovoltaic response. You go in and probe that as a function of wavelength to get the external quantum efficiency. You can see that you get a really nice response from the nanotubes themselves. So these are the first excitonic transitions of the nanotubes themselves. So essentially what you're getting is your photoexcited nanotubes transferring the electron to the fullerene, percolating through the electron in this fullerene phase, the hole in this nanotube phase, and you get a nice solar cell. An interesting result that they get is this diameter-dependent quantum efficiency. So if you look at the internal quantum efficiency as a function of diameter, essentially you get to this, you have fairly high internal quantum efficiencies of about 80% or so. And then you get to this diameter of about 1 nanometer where it all of a sudden jumps down quite a bit. The thought behind that is that you have these diameter-dependent homo-luma levels, And what you're doing is you're transferring electron from the LUMO of the nanotube to the LUMO of the C60. So at some point you reach a diameter where the LUMO of the nanotube is now below the LUMO of the C60. So you can no longer efficiently dissociate those excitons. The driving force of the charge transfer is just too low. That's a direct consequence, really, of the higher binding energies of these nanotubes. So Dominic has come here for the summer to work with us doing some TRMC on these blends. These are some results that we've gotten in recent days. So essentially what we're doing here is we're photoexciting the nanotubes at 1205. So we're photoexciting this particular nanotube species right here. Either in the absence of C60, this orange trace, or the presence of C60 in this purple trace. In both cases, the transient is kind of dominated by the nanotubes because you're photoexciting the nanotubes, you have some response from the nanotubes just themselves, but there's some really important differences. In the absence of C60, you have a signal intensity of about 0.3 here. It jumps up by a factor of about 3 when you add C60. So again, that jump in the signal for this microwave conductivity measurement means you're dissociating excitons and producing a higher density of free charge carriers. Also, you get this nice long-lived signal. So this is like a microsecond long type signal where you don't see that in the nanotube-only film. So if you do an action spectrum of this type of bilayer, so here the spectra are nanotube absorbance alone in the red. So this is PFO out here. This is the second excitonic transition of the nanotubes, first excitonic transitions of the nanotubes. This is the nanotubes with C60. When you do the action spectrum for TRMC, what we're plotting here is the amplitude of this long time constant, so this near microsecond time constant. It traces out the absorption of the nanotubes quite well, and then you also get this nice contribution from the C60. What you will notice is that at this particular wavelength right here, about 1250, you see a large decrease after you get to these larger diameter tubes where you don't see as much of that long time constant. So this met, if you overlay the external quantum efficiency on top of this, it's actually quite a nice match. And this is really that diameter cutoff where we said you go from having a type 2 band offset to having a type 1 band offset where the LUMO is now below the LUMO of the C60. So you no longer have that driving force for exciton association. So this is a really nice example of how you can actually compare these microwave conductivity measurements to device characteristics. So I'll talk a little bit here in the last part of the talk on carbon-based transparent conducting electrodes for OPV. So again, looking at single-wall carbon nanotube thin films and graphene thin films. So a lot of you are probably familiar with transparent contacts and thin film UV. They tend to be what are called TCOs, transparent conducting oxides, because they're typically based on oxide materials like tin doped indium oxide, ITO, aluminum doped zinc oxide, which is AZO. This is FTO, which is tin oxide, or cadstanic. So these are really nice because they have high transmittance and low sheet resistance. And that's really what you're trying to do in this type of application. You're trying to transmit as much light through as possible to your active layer. You get charge carrier formation in your active layer, but then you also want them to be very conductive laterally so that once the charges reach this conducting film, you can transport them out of the devices to make a good photocurrent. However, they have some drawbacks. They're not typically flexible, so if you deposit a film of ITO, it tends to be pretty brittle, so if you put this onto like a polymer film and then bend it and stretch it and stuff like that, the ITO it's pretty brittle and just breaks. So you end up with something that's very conductive for a couple of bending cycles and then just completely craps out. They're also made with fairly expensive deposition techniques. So you have to use vacuum deposition, high temperature deposition, which adds money to your process. You know, where you really want to go with photovoltaics, obviously, is as low of a cost per watt as possible. So these things tend to add a significant amount to the cost of a photovoltaic. So we're in our group, we're looking at a lot of different roll-to-roll TCs, transparent conductors, for OPV and other types of photovoltaics. When I say roll-to-roll, you can make these things in very large areas very quickly. So if you think about taking a Think about taking a flexible film and just rolling that over an area where you have a sprayer spraying down your transparent conductor onto that sheet. You can make these things in, you know, meters squared per minute, you know, very, very quickly. We're trying to do these things based on abundant source materials, so using carbon and using metallic nanowires that have pretty abundant source materials like copper. You can do these things at fairly low cost and at atmospheric pressure and low temperature. So this is just kind of an economic slide where we actually try to do an analysis with our economic analysis group at NREL, where we try to actually compare the real cost of these roll-to-roll transparent conductors versus traditional TCOs. A couple things you'll see here is if you use the carbon nanotube transparent conductor as a test case, the transparent electrode material is fairly high. Carbon nanotubes aren't particularly cheap right now. The cost is coming down quite a bit, but the raw material is still a decent amount higher than you would like it to be for materials like AZO. Where you really win out in these types of things is capital equipment. So as I said, these transparent conducting oxides utilize vacuum deposition and these deposition techniques that cost quite a bit of money, and that actually ends up increasing your cost quite a bit. So if you compare a carbon nanotube cost in per meter squared, we think that you should actually be able to get to about half of ITO. But if you start to go to silver nanowires and copper nanowires, you're actually at a factor of 10 lower. And graphene would probably be more in the neighborhood of maybe a dollar per meter squared. So scalable production of nanotube TC. So essentially what we're doing here is trying to think of scalable ways we can produce these. As I said, this is a real advantage of these types of materials. You can process them into inks and then spray them over large areas. So in this case, we're using a technique called ultrasonic spraying, where you have your ink down here. This is a liquid inlet, and you essentially atomize your ink over here on this ultrasonic nozzle, and it's directed down your substrate with an inert gas flow. So you can raster a translation stage back and forth, and then spray large areas of nanotube thin films over whatever substrate you'd like. So this is kind of an example of a 6x6 inch nanotube transparent conducting film. You can also do patterns very easily. So this is a pattern for a device chip where we're going to make 6 different OPP devices on it. And this is what what the nanotubes look like when you make these transparent conducting films. They're really a two-dimensional network, kind of a spaghetti of nanotubes. So we want to know exactly what matters when you're thinking about making an nanotube transparent conductor. So there's a couple different things to think about when you think about these transparent conductors. One is the fact that you have different electronic structures of tubes within your blend. You have semiconducting tubes and you have metallic tubes. So the electronic structure here is going to control the density of carriers at the Fermi level. So for an intrinsic semiconducting tube, you're right in the middle of the gap and you shouldn't have any carriers. It should be pretty much insulated. Metallic tube won't be. There's also junctions. So as I said, these things are two-dimensional networks where there's lots and lots of nanotube junctions. These junctions tend to be barriers for transport from one tube to the next. So this is going to control things like the mobility and carrier scattering. So one trick you can play is a trick similar to a field effect transistor, where you use a gate voltage to essentially inject high density of carriers into the semiconductor tubes to turn them on. In this case, we're utilizing the fact that nanotubes, just like graphene, are essentially 100% surface, so you can absorb charge transfer molecules onto their surface to give you essentially degenerately doped semiconductors. So this is an example where you take hydrazine, absorb hydrazine onto your nanotube surface, and you get this nice pool of negative charge that is delocalized around that hydrazine moiety. So this makes this delocalized electronic charge gives you an N-type single wall carbon nanotube and an N-type film. So essentially, it's pushed the Fermi level well up into the conduction band. You can also do this with a SiC species to give you P-type materials. So essentially, you can take the semiconducting tubes and turn them on. What this looks like if you measure an absorbance spectrum. So this is an absorbance. These are absorbance spectra where we've put different acidic species, either thionyl chloride or nitric acid, on the surface of semiconducting enriched films. In this case, you have these nice optical transitions for the intrinsic tubes. This is the first excitonic transition for the semiconductor tubes, second and third. You take that and dope these things with these molecules, and these optical transitions are completely quenched. So essentially, what you're doing is you're pushing the Fermi level way down into this, way down into the valence band. You turn off these optical transitions because there's no longer carriers to absorb. You also get this nice tail, which is actually a free carrier tail. And the other thing is that you get a very large reduction in the shear resistance. So the shear resistance is how essentially tells you how well you're transporting carriers across your sheet. You go from about 16,000 ohm per square, so very insulating, to about 180 ohm per square for these heavily P-type doped semiconducting tubes. So you can turn the semiconducting tubes on. The metallic tubes, if you look back at this right here, metallic tubes, when we use these dopants, you're not pushing the Fermi level low enough to actually get lower than this first band Hope singularity. So you shouldn't actually change the absorbance spectrum of these metallic tubes, and you really shouldn't change the conductivity if you're thinking about a single tube, because you have fairly monotonic, small increase in the density of states going from intrinsic to this P-type case. But you see some interesting effects. This is a metallic enriched film, 99% metallic tubes. As we add these dopants, as expected, we don't see any quenching of the optical transition in the metallic tube, because we haven't gone low enough at the Fermi level. But we see very large decreases, factors of four decreases in the shear resistance. So the reason that happens is because you do have these junctions in between tubes, and there's an activation barrier associated with transmitting a carrier through that barrier. You can see this in the temperature-dependent resistance. So if you lower the temperature from 300 Kelvin to temperature down to about 100 Kelvin, for an intrinsic, nearly all metallic tube film, you get this increase in the resistance. This is not what you would expect for a truly metallic film. A truly metallic film will be dominated by photon backscattering, and you would expect to go from a low resistance to a high resistance as you increase the temperature. But that's not what happens, so that's what that's telling you is essentially the metallic conductivity is over, overrun, is dominated by this junction resistance. What the dopants are doing is essentially adsorbing near these junctions and lowering the activation barrier for getting through these junctions. So you actually get, in these films, you actually get transport from metallic tubes and doped semiconductors. So it's not as straightforward as you would think as to what types of tubes you would want. Both work just fine. So this is so nanotubes are kind of one piece of the puzzle in our portfolio of nanostructured orbital transparent conductors. We're also looking at metallic nanowires like silver and copper, graphene thin films, and so the best graphene that we've gotten so far is growing a two-layer graphene sample on copper. So we actually grow two layers directly on the copper. We transfer that to our substrate and then dope that with nitric acid. That puts us at about 50 ohm per square, 88% transmittance. So that's this blue curve. You can see that compares pretty well to ITO in terms of transmittance, but the shear resistance is still a little higher than ITO. So that's something we're close to getting improvement on. But the other best result we've got with graphene is you can actually grow a single layer on copper and then transfer sequentially two single layers to give you a double layer. There we get about 100 ohms per square, 88% transmittance. I will point out that one of the important characteristics of these transparent conductors, these carbon-based transparent conductors, and metallic nanowires actually, is that you get much better transmittance of light in the infrared. So what that does for you is if you're trying to make, say, for instance, a tandem device where you're absorbing a lot of the visible light at the top layer but you want to transmit infrared light to your bottom layer, these carbon-based conductors are going to do a lot better in terms of transmitting that infrared light to your bottom layer. Films like ITO really start to tail away in their transmittance as you go into the infrared region because of free carrier absorbance. This is just a recent paper that we put out comparing the fundamental physics and how these things actually function in devices for metallic nanowires, graphene, and nanotubes, comparing them with real TCO. So, so how do these things actually work in PV devices? We put these things in organic photovoltaics. In this case, in this example right here, we have a nanotube film that we've overcoated with P.PSS, which is a full transport layer for the OPV devices. Then put your active layer of P3HT PCBM and then aluminum contact in the back. They perform quite well compared to ITO. Not too bad of a hit in the power conversion efficiency. We've also used these things in CIGS cells and CadTel cells. So the CadTel cells shown right here, we get an efficiency of about 12.4%, which isn't just like great compared to the world record holders for those devices. But as I said, we have built interesting structures where we can actually do the transparent conductor down here and transmit light through to another bottom cell. So this would actually be used in a tandem cell. So they do have advantages. I'll talk a little bit about this in the last part. There's some key differences between these ITO electrodes and nanotube electrodes for those who'd like to look at how these devices actually work. One thing is that the ITO devices actually perform horribly if you remove that P.PSS whole transport layer. P.PSS is good for these solar cells in that it makes them work, but it's also one of the things that leads to device degradation. It kind of kills the ITO layers. In contrast, when we make nanotube devices without P.PSS, so this is nanotube P.dot 4.13% nanotube device without P.dot, you don't get so bad of a reduction in the efficiency. The series resistance is also lower for nanotubes, so this is you can see that out here where. If you look at the nanotube device without P-dot, it actually makes really nice contact with the active layer, and your series resistance is the best. So that's good for device performance. The work function is also higher for nanotubes than it is for ITO. And this is one area where the P-dot actually, we think that the P-dot is working for these ITO devices because the P-dot coated devices, the ITO, work function goes down to 4.8, which matches a little bit better with the higher work function of nanotubes. I think that's one of the reasons ITO is necessary in these, P-dot is necessary in these ITO devices. The problem being that, the main problem is that the shunt resistance, which is essentially telling you you've got carriers going in the wrong direction, that resistance is lower. You want that to be as high as possible. The shunt resistance is lower for the nanotubes, which probably just means that you have nanotubes kind of intercalated a little bit into the active layer, and current can go in the wrong direction. So this is just to conclude. I hope that I convinced you that in these two talks that these messy nanotube samples that are very polydispersed can be cleaned up using appropriate separation techniques. When you clean them up, they enable fundamental studies in PV devices where you can actually learn about which types of nanotubes you'd want to make functioning PV devices. There are some limiting factors for nanotubes. Acceptors in OPV, you get energy transfer, recombination metallic tubes, and one thing that we did talk about is diameter, at least for the nanotube fullerene devices. You can also make high surface area nanotube conducting electrodes and graphene electrodes. Both the metallic tubes and the heavily doped semiconducting tubes are very conductive. You have junction limited transport, and you can use these things in a variety of different architectures. So these are the acknowledgments of all the people that have done all this great work. And with that, I'll conclude the second talk.
Questions for John?
In the slide, right before you started talking about transparent contacts, you showed the absorption drops off as it gets like 1200 nanometer away from it. Somehow you related this drop-off and absorptions to the diameter of the diameter of the nanotube. I'm not seeing how you relate the way of the nanotube.
Sorry, I maybe rushed to that a little bit. so essentially what you're looking at here
is the first exciton transition for a variety of tubes. So you've got maybe one exciton transition here for this shoulder, another one here, one here, one here, one here, and then one here for this shoulder. As you go from short wavelength or high energy to long wavelength or low energy, that change in energy is for that exciton transition is defined by the diameter of the tube. So these are larger diameter tubes out here. These are smaller diameter tubes over here. And so essentially what you're seeing here is that you get really nice overlap with the absorbance spectrum for the smaller diameter tubes, and that kind of falls off as you get to these larger diameter tubes. And that's because you have these diameter-dependent homoenthalmal potentials. So for the smaller diameter tubes, you have a type 2 band offset. You have a driving force for that electron transfer reaction. And then for the large diameter tubes, you end up type 1. So there's no driving force to transfer that electron from the nanotube to the C60. That makes sense?
Yeah.
You made the exciton transport for the nanotube sound like a bad thing, but could it be a good thing too? I mean, I wonder what the mobility of an exciton that's been transported to the nanotube is, and maybe that's just a good way of harvesting excitons and trying to separate them later.
Sure, yeah, I think it probably could be. There are people who use some of these energy transfer cascade type films and quantum dots. And I guess there are potential routes for doing that with nanotubes as well. But yeah, in terms of kind of a more simple bilayer device or bulk heterojunction device, we want to avoid that. But yeah, you're right. There are potential opportunities to take advantage of that. So you bring up a very good point. There are, so the excitons that we typically talk about are the bright excitons. There's 16, the degeneracy is about 16 for the nanotube excitons. So there's 15 other excitons, if you look just around the first exciton, that are dark and are either forbidden by spin considerations, like a triplet exciton, or by momentum. And so there are a number of dark excitons. We're studying those actively. We've uncovered some important results about where the energies of those dark excitons lie, and we're trying to think about how these dark excitons will affect device performance, and a lot of work has been done on how they affect photoluminescence. So there's been a lot of studies on taking these things down to lower temperatures and magnetic fields to cause degeneracy splitting, and actually you can see some of the dark excitons that way. And you can start to calculate how the splitting of those excitons affects the photoluminescence efficiency. Because the very lowest energy exciton is a dark exciton. But it's lucky in the fact that it's actually a fairly small splitting. It's only a few MeV. So at room temperature, you're fine for that dark exciton. However, there are other dark excitons that are accessible at room temperature that do affect photoluminescence efficiency. I don't know if that actually answered your question, but those states, those levels are present. They affect the photoluminescence efficiency. They're going to affect how things work in devices, and people are thinking about that. We're definitely thinking about that. One thing that I could relay in terms of one of those dark excitons is there's a dark exciton that is momentum forbidden, but it actually shows up as a sideband because you can see it as a vibronic transition. So it's forbidden unless you absorb with the contribution of the phonon. So you actually see that in the absorbance spectrum of nice isolated tubes. For those nanotube fullerene devices, when you measure the internal quantum efficiency, as you go from, if you have a nice near single chirality sample, as you go from the first exciton to that vibronic sideband to the second exciton, the internal quantum efficiency is about the same. So for some of those dark excitons, they're actually just fine. In terms of how they affect device performance.
Other questions? Yeah. Okay, thank you for two questions.